Welcome everybody to our next webinar, which is the introduction to the role model videos for our pre-competitive events. Jenna's gonna be doing the presentation tonight. I just wanted to, before we get started, to remind you that the role models, they have been approved by the technical committee, but they will not become official until they're approved at the CBTF board meeting, which is next Sunday. So I'll acknowledge that we kind of jumped the gun a little bit at the technical meeting. We're excited about these. And we did put an effective date of February 1st, but we can't make them official until we do get that approval at the board meeting next week. And then for that reason, you won't see them posted on the website until next week. Usually we get stuff posted right away following the webinar, but we're going to hold off until they are approved next week. So with that, I will hand it over to Jenna.
Hi, everyone, and good evening. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm really excited to be presenting our new pre-competitive role models. This is a project that I've been working on for almost 2 years, so it's really exciting to see it, be presented to you guys. And I think it's a really great resource that we're going to have for our judges. So I was on the committee, as well as Sarah joined to help me with some revisions. And our subcommittee was Maureen Johnson and the education committee members. So as always, it's been really important for myself as the judges rep to have a lot of eyes and a lot of input on these projects that we do. So it is more of a seamless rollout once it is approved from the technical and the board, so that everyone's really on board with it and can get behind it. So our strategy, a little bit different for the pre-competitive role models. If you remember, a couple of weeks ago, we presented on the new competitive routine role models, which was our medley and solo dance and those things. So for those role models, we really wanted to use videos that were selected for the right reasons, versus your pre-comp athletes are a lot different. There's a lot more error. You see a lot more deviation from the standard routine. You may see a lot of missing elements in the program, or possibly them forgetting or being way off the music. So it was important for us to incorporate some of those kind of wild cards that we see sometimes as judges, and you don't really know how to react, or how do you reward or how do you penalize for those type of performances. So they're not there necessarily for the right reasons in regard to doing the routine really well or what have you, but I think it's an accurate representation of what we do see at that level. It might be an athlete's first ever competition. It might be overwhelming to them, just being out in front of a judge. So I think it's important that we encourage and support those athletes, and we're not penalizing them too much, but we also want to make sure that we're not overcompensating and rewarding them too high either. So why is that important? It is important because the pre-competitive athletes are the future of our sports. We want to keep those athletes in our sports so that they grow up to become competitive athletes. We as judges must be able to accurately score these athletes and be able to provide proper feedback to encourage and support them. We have to make sure that we're consistent in our scoring. It's very important to the athletes at any age, but especially at such a young age, it's important that they're receiving, consistent grades, maybe improving a little bit at each competition as they improve. We want to make sure that the parents and the coaches are getting those consistent scores so that, the athlete really understands, okay, when I put in more work, I get rewarded. When I do a better job, I get rewarded, instead of kind of that roller coaster we sometimes see with the pre-competitive events. So it's really great that we're now going to have a standard of excellence in our pre-competitive program, because, that is the foundation of all of our athletes. It also is important to enforce proper baton and body technique at this level, which should be reflected in the athlete score. We always talk a lot about the most important thing as judges is to evaluate the proper baton and body technique. So we want to make sure that we're enforcing that at a young age, so that, the athlete, again, we're not overcompensating by trying to encourage them. We're trying to strive to have some sort of balance between that. So let's talk a little bit about the challenges. So it is often difficult at competitions to have the proper amount of time to provide adequate feedback to our pre-competitive athletes. So I know sometimes maybe the pre-competitive is at the end of the day or first thing in the morning, you know, and the competition director says to you, we got to stay on time. You only have, you know, 30 seconds or a minute in between the set. So even though these events happen so quickly and, you know, their routines may only be 45 seconds, it's really important. I've heard this time and time again from coaches that they do get the feedback from us as judges. So it's really important that judges are familiar with the score sheets to utilize the checks and the circles method. So that's kind of your best way as a judge to kind of fill out that score sheet is, you know, circle any errors you see, check anything that you want to reward. That's so important because, I mean, I think a lot of, you know, even those parents, they expect that on those score sheets. And that's encouraging to the athlete as well to see that. And they know the exact areas they need to work on, even though the coach has probably told them time and time again to point your toes when they see it on the score sheet from the judge. Oh, okay. I guess maybe I should be doing that. So that's one way that we can provide proper feedback. And it's really important that the judges must be able to confidently direct their clerks and utilize their ability to provide written feedback. So, you know, I think this goes back to really knowing the routines. I think that's hard as judges, if you're not a coach, to really, you know what the standard routine is. So you have to be really confident in knowing these programs in order to provide that feedback and be really comfortable with the score sheets because they all look quite different. So I think, you know, with these new pre-competitive role models, this gives you an opportunity to watch more, you know, selections of athletes that you might see at a higher or lower level. You know, as we know, some of those standard routines that we have as examples online are quite high level athletes. So sometimes that can look a little bit different when we have a new athlete performing those routines. And then one other thing I just wanted to touch on, this project, we tried to complete it as much as we could with the video footage that we had on the video library. So some of them you may notice they're, you know, missing an A or missing a D. That was because we just weren't confident in finding an athlete that really suited that score. So this is something that as we get more videos, we'll be kind of adding to the role models. We're not going to be changing anything that we have right now, but you'll see at the end, we only have one dance twirl team. So we would like to add to that. And maybe as we see some more virtual competitions continue this year, we might be able to get some more recordings to be able to add to the video library and then add some additional resources here. So what we're gonna do is we won't have time to review all of the role models for the pre-competitive events, but we're gonna do a selection of a few. We're going to watch the first three or four examples, A to C or A to D that we may have. And Dana's going to share the videos for me, and then we'll kind of go back and take a look at the script. And we'll wait till the end of, you know, forward motion one, viewing all the videos, seeing the script, and then we'll see if there's any questions and then move on to the next event, just so that we're keeping that momentum through. So I'm going to end my screen sharing here, and then we will be watching forward motion one, A, B, and C. So here's just the script, which we'll go over in a little bit more detail once we've gone through the rest of the videos. Okay. So we have one more athlete to view, and that is the C athlete. So hopefully you were able to right away recognize a difference between those three athletes. So I'm just going to pull up the script here for us to look at, make it a little bit bigger so you can see. So for the A scoring athlete, she received excellent in all captions. So any comments that were a positive to her, obviously you can see noted here. So her body technique was one of the big things that stood out that made her an A, as well as her timing. She was very musical. She understood the demands of the music, as well as she was able to coordinate the baton and body well together. The athlete who was our B example, as you could see from her, bent knees and, lack of turnout, she only scored good in her body technique. So that is kind of what dropped her down to what we would call a B. And, she also understood the demands of the music. She had good she had good body and baton coordination, but overall it was her body technique that was her biggest weakness that brought her down. And then level C, I thought, was a good example. She definitely had quite a few errors, but for the most part, she was doing what she needed to be doing, but just not really in a masterful way. So, quite a few errors, but, she was pretty much, with the music. Her body technique definitely needs some improvement. That was reflected there. But I think it's important. Sometimes we see a routine performs like that, and it's not fair to really overreact to some of those deficiencies that she had. So for us, that we felt that's why that she would fall in that C category. So is there any questions with the forward motion one before we move on to forward motion two? Okay, I will take that as a no, and we will switch back over to watch the forward motion two video. And I believe there's three examples here as well for A, B, and C. So for tonight, we're just introducing the pre-competitive role models. I think it would be fun to do another webinar later on once these are published for everyone to do a little play the game webinar with the pre-competitive athletes to put these new role models in place or put them, to use in practice. So she obviously had superior body technique. So she was our A here. Thank you. And moving on to our last athlete with an overall grade of C. So in pulling up the script here, the first athlete was very strong in her body technique. So comparing her to the forward motion 1A athlete, I would say the forward motion 2A athlete was very much superior, but there's different variables of athletes that you will see in the level A. So, you know, an A athlete can look a little bit different than another A athlete. So I think that's okay. So she received excellent in all of her captions. The second athlete, she really struggled with her body technique the most. She really lacked the proper turnout that we're looking for, as well as that releve position, switching behind the knees. She's starting to develop some performance skills, but not quite there with the confidence yet. And then our C athlete, you could see that she struggled with the footwork a little bit. Knowing the proper footwork, she wasn't turning out at all, and she had some timing issues. Her chassis were quite fast, and then some mechanical errors, she had an incorrect starting position, as well as some errors with the step retiré there. So again, I think that there's a noticeable difference between those athletes. We wanted to try and pick athletes where there was a clear separation between the A, the B, and the C. We had a few athletes that were kind of on the fence, maybe could be one or the other, but I think that these were all really strong examples for the forward motion 1 and 2 pre-competitive role models. So I'll just check in quick to see if there's any questions. If not, I believe we'll move into medley 1 and 2 next. Okay, great. Yes, so Dana, if you can pull up the medley examples here. And so for medley 1 and medley 2, we have the full range of A, B, C, and D. So we also thought it would be important to try and include some older athletes as well in these pre-competitive role models. It's not always the younger, 5, 6, 7, 8-year-olds we see. Well, they probably do that. And then moving on to our last athlete. So in Medley, obviously we see a more demanding choreography in this event. So I think you'll see a lot more deviation from the standard routine. You'll probably see a lot more errors in timing and correct footwork. So as you can see, there was a lot of differences between some of those athletes. So just pulling up the script here. And again, like I was mentioning, I think it was important to include some older athletes as well that we might see in the pre-competitive programs. So our first athlete was excellent in all captions. Our second athlete had a few just kind of technical deficiencies, which brought her down to a B. Our level C athlete, she started to have a little bit of deviation from the proper musicality and program itself. And then as you could see in our last athlete, the example for D, she deviated quite a bit from the standard routine, didn't have a good understanding of the musicality quite yet. So that would be an athlete that we would really encourage to write a lot more positive comments, encouraging comments on her score sheet, maybe an extra sticker or something, you know, just to kind of say, okay, you know, you're there, you're getting there, but you need to go back and, you know, keep working. So I think when we talk about utilizing the score sheet, I think it's important to take the time for some of those athletes that might be getting a C or a D and spend a little bit more time adding a few extra comments on their score sheet so that the athlete has some guidance going forward, or is not discouraged by receiving that color ribbon when she sees all of the positive comments on the score sheet. So we will now move on. If there's any questions, please know. If not, we'll move on to the Medley 2 examples. And moving on to our next one of an overall grade of B. So sometimes we do see our athlete drop in those pre-competitive events. So we wanted to include an example as well that had that type of error in her program. Thank you. So in medley, obviously technique is so important. So I think you'll notice as we go from our A, B, C, and D selections, that standard of technique is a little bit lower from each athlete. Oftentimes we'll see an athlete maybe pause in the program because they're really early or if they've forgotten. So again, we wanted to try and include some of those examples that you'll see in real life when you get out and are judging. So athletes who was our A example, really excellent body technique, really excellent baton and body coordination, musicality. She really was mastering that program. Our level B example or level B score. She was pretty good, but just not quite same mastery that we saw with that A example. So there's a few things that she needs to work on and a few things that just need to be corrected. With the level C example, she had a few technical errors in her lower body, as well as some weak baton work that needs to be better developed. And the musicality as well. And then moving to our last example, she had a lot of deviation from the program. Her technique is one of the biggest things that she needs to work on. So again, including some encouraging comments there for that example. So that is our medley selections. So we will move on to our solo. And then we have a team example after that as well. To remember that we don't always see straight excellent in all of the captions in order for an athlete to receive the A ranking. There's so many ways to come up with those scores. We'll be right back. annual event. I think we see a lot of athletes going over the meet. It's a very common occurrence. So it's important, I think, for these athletes that we keep watching them and not drop our eyes down to the paper to start commenting and to grade them. And next we have our C selection. And we have one more here, which is our selection for the D role model. So solo can be particularly challenging to judge just because there's so much content in the solo event. So sometimes it's overwhelming for the athletes. It's overwhelming for us to kind of really, accurately score them. They might be quite strong in their vertical series, but really struggle with some of those rolls and some of those horizontals. So, constantly we're trying to balance the scale of what do we reward, what do we penalize for, and how much. So again, wanted to show some different examples, some deviation from the routine, some athletes that scored a bit higher, the A and B, but they did have some errors. So again, it's really important to remember there's so many combinations to really come up with these levels, these rankings of A, B, C, or D. So it's important as judges we're familiar. We don't necessarily have to memorize that chart, but I think it's important just so that you're kind of aware of how many of each caption kind of correlates to the scores, especially now because that's not something that we're in charge of calculating, which gives us more time to give those comments on the score sheets, which is really important. So our A example, she did have some errors for sure, but she was still an A. Our B example struggled a little bit, but she was able to successfully complete the program with some technical errors in her baton and body work. But, she's getting there with some more practice and some more confidence. Our level C example, struggled a little bit more, is not quite as confident with the baton work yet. And then our D example, some deviation, some breaks, went over the music, those type of things that all contributed to a lower score. So, looking at, forward motion to compare to solo in the pre-competitive, it's very different to judge. The demand in your forward motion and demand in your solo is quite different. So I think you have to really look at each event and make sure that you can identify based on the captions, okay, what am I really looking at and rewarding here, or what am I really looking at to penalize here? So any questions on solo one? If not, we'll move on to solo two. To remember for solo two, the illusion's not something that you're considering for their captions or for their overall grade. It's just a way for them to start that technique. And the next one will be our overall grade of C.
Thank you.
So we tried not to pick athletes for more than one event, but just kind of the way the video library worked. Most of the athletes, we had all of the routines that they had done at a few competitions. So that's why you see a few. To remember too, as we jump from solo one to solo two, obviously to level C, there's going to be an increase of expectation that we have as judges for those athletes. So it's really important at that second level of each of those pre-competitive events that we are rewarding them appropriately so that the coach has a good idea of whether it's ready for them to move to that level C or if they need to stay in that level two of those pre-competitive events. So any questions about solo? We do just have one dance world team after this. Quickly just reviewing the role model scripts for this. Our first athlete was excellent in all of her captions. Our second athlete had really good full hand work, but then struggled trying to do some of the more advanced skills, such as the backhand flip technique. Our C example had some struggles with pattern. And then our D selection, I think she was frozen for, I don't know if that was just on my computer, but she kind of glitched there for a second, but she had some struggles with her proper pattern, forward and reverse direction, her body technique, as well as her connections. So that's why she was selected for our D example. So we will move on to our dance twirl team. We just have one video selection of A. So just a reminder, you know, it's really important that you guys are submitting any video that you have from competitions that you have maybe previously recorded and haven't submitted yet to CBTF, because we do pull from those libraries to create our role models.
Music.
it's nice that on the video you guys will have published that. You'll be able to see all those scripts. That's helpful. So this dance troll team too scored excellent in all of their captions. I think, you know, we all know why. They had really good precision unison. They all had really good technique. The demand of the baton technique was superior, and they worked as a team well together, as well as they understood the transitions and forms in their program. So that's all that we had time to share with you guys tonight. We did do the pre-competitive role models for two baton, solo dance, basic march, and twirl team. So we could do another hour just reviewing those other events, but perhaps for another time. And perhaps once we get more comfortable and once you have some time to review these role models on your own, we can do a little bit of practical application as well and do some practice judging. So I want to thank everyone for joining on tonight and participating in the webinar. If you have any questions, my email is there, and please send them my way. We also have a few more webinars coming up here, which I'm sure you guys all know about, so make sure you register for them. If there's any questions now, we can open that up. So you can either raise your hand or put something in the chat box.
While we're waiting for any questions to pop up, I'll just remind everyone that we'll get these approved. I don't see any barrier to getting them approved next weekend at the board meeting. And then as part of the CBTF website, you'll need to log in to your account on the CBTF website. And so I'm guessing it'll be next Monday that this will be up. Jeff has it ready to go. We just have to hit the go live button. But you'll log into your account on the CBTF website. There'll be a page dedicated to the pre-competitive role models. It'll have all of the videos by event listed there for you to view. It'll also have the PDF of the scripts. So Jenna brought those up on the screen. It's one PDF with all of the scripts in it, but one page per event. So if you're the type of person that likes to print things out, you'll have one page per event in your binder. And I think that's it. The videos will also be on the YouTube account in a playlist if you want to watch them all at once. And within the script, you'll be able to click on the title at the top and it'll take you directly to that event playlist. So thanks to Jeff for putting those playlists together and doing all of the typing up of the scripts within the videos. Tons of work, and he got that all ready for us. And we look forward to everybody making use of those in the coming season and seasons, I guess it is. So if I don't know if any questions popped up, but if not.
I don't see any in the chat box, Dana. So that's a win for me. I'm sure I'll get some questions afterwards once you guys have some time to go through them. So please reach out if you do have any comments for us.
Great. Thanks for joining us tonight. And thanks so much to Jenna and your team that did all the work on this. Long time coming. And I'm so excited that we have something for our judges to use now.
Thanks, Dana. Thanks everyone. You.